Good morning, church. Welcome. Would you stand? We're going to open our service with a call to worship, which comes this morning from Psalm 103. The scripture will be on the screen behind me here, and I'll have you join me in reading the bolded text aloud. Praise the Lord, O my soul. All my inmost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Praise the Lord, you his angels, you mighty ones who do his bidding, who obey his word. Praise the Lord, all his heavenly hosts, you his servants who do his will. Praise the Lord, all his works, everywhere in his dominion. Praise the Lord, O my soul. Let us join with the psalmist this morning in declaring our praises. Our God, a firm foundation, our rock, the only solid ground. The nations rise and fall. The kingdoms once strong, now shaken. We trust forever in your name, the name of Jesus. We trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. Unmatched in your wisdom, unmatched in all your wisdom, in love and justice you will reign, and every knee will bow. We bring our expectations, our hope is anchored in your name, the name of Jesus. Oh, we trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. We lift our banner high. We lift the name of Jesus. From age to age you reign. Your kingdom has no end. We lift our banner high. We lift the name of Jesus. From age to age you reign. Your kingdom has no end. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You can grab a seat.
Well, good morning, everybody. It's good to see you. Welcome. We have an opportunity now to continue with our time of worship with a chance to give to the Lord with our tithes and offerings. This is the first Sunday of the month, and every first Sunday of the month, we take a time during our worship service to collect our offerings to the Lord. And the reason we do this is for a number of reasons, and I say this a lot because I think it's helpful. One, giving back to God helps us remember that the earth is the Lord's and everything in it, and everything that we have comes from Him. And so in this time of giving, we have an opportunity to express our faith and trust that God is our provider. He's the one who cares for us and will continue to provide for us. And by giving back to Him, we recognize that what we have comes from Him and He will continue to provide. It also gives us an opportunity to express gratitude to God, to say thank you to Him for all that we have and to give back. So this morning, I want to encourage us to give with joyful hearts. The scripture encourages us to give generously, not by compulsion, but with cheerfulness. And so in a moment, we're going to have the baskets will come around to collect what we have to give today. And before we do that, I'm going to just pray for this time and ask God to use what we're able to give this morning for His glory and for His kingdom. So let's take a moment and pray. Father, we thank you for all that you do for us. We thank you for all the ways that you take care of us, that you know each one of us. You've given each of us our lives, and daily you provide for us in every way that we need. So we thank you for this opportunity that we have now to give to you and to your work in and through your people, your church. So we ask that God that all that is given this morning, would you take it and use it for your glory, multiply your church, multiply your gospel across this world, and bring more and more people to know salvation in Jesus. We ask that you would use this church to be part of that as well and what we're able to do this morning. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Would you stand as we continue worshiping in song?
I'll bless your name, O God, each day that I awake. From dawn to setting sun, your greatness I'll proclaim. Your glory far exceeds all human thought. So with each breath I'll bless your name, O God. Your name will be revered by children yet to come. As generations sing wonders you have done, your strong and mighty deeds are always near. Oh God, Most High, your name will be. Gracious and provides for all who live and breathe. Your mercy runs to find the helpless and the weak. When we call out to you, you hear our cries, and all our needs you're gracious and provides. When works of wicked men you finally destroy, your power will proclaim till Christ descends, and you will reign forever without end. How great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. How great is the Lord our God. How great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised.
We come to time in our service, as we do every week, where we have a call to confession. And so hear the word of the Lord from Hebrews 4 this morning, and then take a moment in prayer. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses. We have one who was tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. And we hear the response to our prayers in this assurance of pardon, which comes from Isaiah 54, 43, and 44. In a surge of anger, I hid my face from you for a moment, but with everlasting kindness, I will have compassion on you, says the Lord, your Redeemer. I, even I, am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake and remembers your sins no more. I have swept away your offenses like a cloud, your sins like the morning mist. Return to me, for I have redeemed you. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns old music but its own. Awake my soul and sing of him who died for thee, and hail him as thy matchless king through all eternity. Crown him the Lord of life, who triumphed o'er the grave and rose victorious in the strife for those he came to save. His glories now we sing, who died and rose on high, who died eternal life to bring, and lives that death may die. Crown inside. Rich wounds yet visible above, in beauty glorified. No angel in the sky can fully bear that sight, but downward bends each burning eye at mystery so bright. Crown in the Lord of years, the potentate of time, creator of the rolling spheres, ineffably sublime. All hail, Redeemer, hail, for thou hast died for me. Thy grace shall never, never fail throughout eternity.
Sing that last line one more time.
All hail, Redeemer, hail, for thou hast died for me. Thy grace shall never, never fail throughout eternity.
Lord God, we declare that you are great and majestic. You rule over all things in power and glory. But you also show us great love and mercy through your provision and especially through Jesus Christ. God, we praise you for all these things this morning and ask that you would continue your work in us as we continue this service. Speak to us through your word and teach us to be the people that you want us to be. Amen. You may be seated.
Well, good morning, everybody. My name is Justin. This is Owen. We'll be welcoming you this morning. We're glad you're here. This morning, as I was rocking Jubilee, our two-month-old, to sleep, I was listening to music, and a song came on called Jesus Christ the Apple Tree. In the lyrics, it's a choral work, and it comes from a poem that was written in the 1700s, and it takes images from Scripture and compares Christ to an apple tree. And especially in light of fall, I thought I'd read a verse this morning. The author of this poem is reflecting on the things in life that were fruitless compared to Christ, longing for happiness and not finding it, except in Christ the apple tree. And the author says this, I'm weary with my former toil. Here I will sit and rest a while. Under the shadow I will be of Jesus Christ the apple tree. I read that to say that this is a church for people who are weary. This is a church for people who have toiled this week. This is a church for people that are needing to sit and rest under the shadow of Jesus Christ. This is not a church for the perfect. This is not a church for those that have it all together, whose every work is fruitful, but for those of us that stumble, trip, and find ourselves lacking in the faith that we need. But it's under the shade that we sit of Jesus Christ, the apple tree, today. And that's why we're here. That's why we gather together. That's why Christians gather together around the world to worship this Jesus who lives that death may die. What amazing news and what an opportunity to be here together. I just have one announcement, and then Owen will take it away to read our passage, and that is a reminder that 6 days from today, that is on Saturday at 5 p.m. at Aldridge Orchards, we are going to have our fall festival. If you haven't been, it's wonderful. Please join. If you have been, you, of course, know that it's a lot of fun. There is opportunity to bring sides, so please reach out to me or Lindsay or James or Alex or someone, and we will get you a link to see what you can sign up for. It takes a village to put on an event like this. Of course, Lindsay is kind of like the main street of the village, and we're all just kind of like little stations along the side. But it takes all of us to do that, and so we're looking forward to that. It starts at 5 p.m. It is open before that, so if you want to go out, like, feel free to enjoy the space before that, but be there at 5 for hayride, for bonfire, for a lot of food and a lot of good time. And as we mentioned several times, this is a great invitation to invite friends. If there's someone in your life that they're the kind of people that you'd say, I'd love to hang out with them, or we enjoy spending time together, and they're looking for community, or they're looking for something fun to do. If your kids play together, whatever it may be, then this is a great opportunity to invite them to join. Now, that being said, would you all please stand if you are able? And Owen, I will let you take it away.
Then God blessed Noah and his sons, saying to them, be fruitful and increase in number and fill the earth. The fear and dread of you will fall on all the beasts of the earth and on all the birds in the sky, on every creature that moves along the ground and on all the fish in the sea. They are given into your hands. Everything that lives and moves about will be food for you. Just as I gave you the green plants, I now give you everything. But you must not eat meat that has its lifeblood still in it. And for your lifeblood, I will surely demand an accounting. I will demand an accounting from every animal and from each human too. I will demand an accounting for the life of another human being. Whoever sheds human blood by human shall their blood be shed. For in the image of God has God made mankind. As for you, be fruitful and increase in number. Multiply the earth and increase upon it. Then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, I now establish my covenant with you and with your descendants after you, and with every living creature that was with you, the birds, the livestock, and all the wild animals, all those that came out of the ark with you, every living creature on earth. I establish my covenant with you. Never again will all life be destroyed by the waters of a flood. Never again will there be a flood to destroy the earth. This is the word of the Lord.
Awesome. Well, thank you, Justin and Owen. Great job, Owen. Thank you, man. What a wonderful day, beautiful fall day. Great to see everybody here this morning. Welcome. If you don't know, my name is James Cottier. I'm the pastor here at Fountain City Church. And hey, you know, kids, yesterday I got to do something I really enjoyed doing. I got to use my smoker. I got to smoke some meat, so I was pretty excited about that. And I finally am getting okay. You guys, I don't know if your mom or dad smoke meat. That means you cook meat on a grill with using a lot of smoke. And it's taken me a while to get good, or get better. I used to cook meat on it, and I would ruin the meat, and I wouldn't do so well. And it made me think of something that's kind of helpful for understanding our passage today. Have you ever done something or started to make something, and you messed up, so you started over? You ever, like, drawn a picture? I'm not a good drawer, and sometimes when I'll try to draw a picture, it doesn't go the way I want it to go, and I'll have to start over. You ever had to do that? Yeah, when I was little, anybody here like to make forts, like out of blankets and pillows? And I loved doing that when I was little, but sometimes I would start making a fort, and it wouldn't really be so good, and I'd have to start over again. You ever have to do that with things? You have to start over? We're going to talk about something in the Bible today that I know some of you will know a little bit about, a story that you know a little bit about, and God is going to tell us something really, really cool through this story. You remember a few weeks ago, we looked at the very beginning of the Bible, and we talked about how God made the world and everything in it. You remember that? God made everything we see, and he made it good. But then last week, do you remember, Pastor Doug preached, and he taught us how human beings in the garden, how Adam and Eve disobeyed God. You remember that? They ate from the fruit of the tree that God said, don't eat. They sinned, and that caused a lot of problems for them and for our whole world, because sin causes problems in our lives and for other people's lives too. Today, we're going to be talking about Noah. Who knows who Noah is? Yeah, who thinks they can tell me pretty quick, what did Noah do? Anybody think they could tell me what Noah did? Henry, I'm going to give you a shot. What did Noah do? He built an ark. And what came into the ark? What did God have bring come into the ark? Bo, animals. So God had all these animals come into the ark that Noah made. And then what happened? Cora, what happened? A big flood came. Yeah, and Noah and all the animals were in the ark, this huge boat, for a really long time. And then the rain stopped and the flood left, and Noah and all the animals got out of the boat. something that's hard for, even for adults to understand, so it's hard for a kid to understand this too, is that the flood was kind of like God, in a way, starting over. Because sin, when Adam and Eve disobeyed, it caused so many problems that God said, I'm just going to start over. So he used the flood to do that. But then he did something after the flood. He made a promise to Noah. And you guys know this because of, you know probably about the rainbow. Everybody know about the rainbow at the end of Noah's story? Yeah, God made a promise to Noah and all of us. He said, I'm never going to start over again. I'm not going to do that anymore. No matter how bad things could be, I'm not going to start over. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to fix it. I'm going to fix it. I'm not starting over. I'm going to fix it. And you know why he's going to fix everything? He's going to fix what's wrong with our lives and what's wrong with the world? Because he loves you. He loves me. He loves all of us. He loves everybody you see. And he's going to fix everything that's wrong. And there's a word for that that we sang about, and you're going to hear me talk about today. And that word is redeem. God is going to redeem all things and all of us in Jesus. And so I want you to listen for that word, redeem or redeemer. And as we're going, I know some of you have some things you can write in your workbooks or draw. Here's what I want you to draw. I want you to draw a picture of the ark, a big boat. Draw some animals. And maybe draw a rainbow. Kind of draw the story of Noah and the ark as I'm talking. And if you can hear me, listen for that word, redeemer. And if you can make a note, just make a note every time I say that. I won't say it till the very end, but you'll hear me say redeemer, okay? Okay, with that, why don't we all take a moment and pray together, and then we will continue with our sermon. So let's take a moment and pray. Father, thank you for this time. We thank you, Lord, for the beautiful morning, the changing of seasons, the coolness in the air in the mornings now. We thank you for this time and place that we can all gather as one people in the name of Jesus to worship you and to give you honor this morning. Lord, we thank you for your grace to us to give us knowledge of who you are and who we are and what this world is and how you are at work in it to give us new and everlasting life in Jesus. We ask that as we open your word this morning that you would teach us, that you would speak to us clearly. Please help me to be clear in what I say. And Lord, use your word this morning to renew our minds that we might all be transformed more and more into the image of Christ. In whose name we pray. Amen. Well, some time ago, it's probably a decade or more ago, I was talking with some younger people, some younger married people, and we were having this conversation, and I don't know why this just kind of stuck in my mind, but it did. And we were talking about kids. We were talking about families. And one of the younger couples who were married said something that just has stuck with me. They said, I don't think I could ever have a child. And I remember saying, you know, we said, well, why not? He said, I don't know how anybody could bring a child into this world. This place is such a bad place. Why would anyone subject a child to it? Now, I was brought up to speed recently by someone else that there's another common sentiment that's kind of a sad sentiment that's common in our time that might be similar or in response to having children in our time. And there's this feeling that people say, I don't think I would ever have to bring a child into this world because it would be unethical because there's too many children already. Yeah, I don't know if any of us kind of struggle with that or think about those issues when we think about the world, but I know that all of us do engage and struggle with the realities that bring about those types of thoughts in others. This world is a difficult place. It's a challenging place. It's a messed up place in many ways. You hear stuff, you know, on the news every day. Your scrolls, your news feeds point this out every day. It's easy to wonder, man, if this world is just going down. Is this whole thing just going to go kaput in a matter of days or months or years or whatever? How are we supposed to live with any confidence or any optimism every day? How do we do that? We've been talking about that a little bit as we looked in the Psalms this past summer, and I know in the past year or so I've mentioned some of that, but today our passage this morning is going to bring us face to face with this question or the answer to this question. How can we live with any confidence or optimism given the world the way that it is? As we continue with our Origins series, we are continuing now, we're in about, I think, week 4 of looking at some of the foundational truths, these origins of our faith that set us up today in our faith in Jesus that help give us a foundation, a platform, a sense of grounding in what is real and true. And this morning we're looking at this passage, the story of Noah, and it's going to help give us a right sense of the world, a right vision of the world. How do we make sense of this world every day? And not only make sense of it, but how do we have joy every day and live courageously every day as well? And so here's what you're going to hear me preaching this morning. Here's the big idea that I'll be working with from this passage. Even in a fallen world, life is still good because we have a Redeemer. Even in a fallen world, life is still good because we have a Redeemer. So we are in Genesis chapter 9. Verses 1 through 11, if you have a Bible and would like to follow along, I'd encourage you to. I'm going to be referring to the passage as we go. So Genesis chapter 9. And I'm going to be unpacking this in three thoughts as usual. And the first one is this: we live in a fallen world. We live in a fallen world. We have to get our mind around that, our hands around that. What does that actually mean? So over the course of the last 3 weeks, we've looked at some significant foundations or origins of our faith as Christians, our Christian faith. First of all, we started off with creation itself, how God created everything that we see, and he created it for good. That was the first thing we saw. Then we zeroed in on human beings and how God made all of humanity in his image. Remember, that was to be a human being is to be made in the image of God. So we looked at that. And then last week, we looked at Genesis chapter 3, and we saw the reality of sin and how human sin in the garden, when Adam and Eve disobeyed God, their distrust in God and their disobedience of God, human sin has brought sadness, pain, death, and curse into the world, into this good creation that God made, and has come into our lives as well. Now, this morning, what we're doing is we're picking up with the aftermath of the garden. So last week, you remember Adam and Eve, they ate the fruit that God from the tree that God said, don't eat. This was sin, and the consequence was they were exiled from the garden, exiled from the presence of the Lord in fullness, exiled from this paradise of Garden of Eden. And now we're going to pick up with the story. What happened after that? Well, in Genesis chapter 4 and 5, we see that what happened was humanity began to spiral and spiral quickly. The snowball effect of just bad went to worse, went to as bad as you can imagine. We see that. We see murder right away. The first generation from Adam and Eve, there was murder. Later on, we see more murder. We see God's intention for marriage begin to break down and be corrupted. We see sexual perversion enter God's good world almost immediately. And it gets so bad that in Genesis chapter 6, verse 5, we see one of the harshest statements in the scripture, at least to my knowledge, about where the world was at after the garden. This is Genesis chapter 5, verse 6. It says, "The Lord saw how great the wickedness of the human race had become on the earth, and that every inclination of the thoughts of the human heart was only evil all the time." Only evil all the time. Did you know that was in the Bible? That is a hard, hard statement. And theologians have a word to describe what that verse is getting at and some other verses in the scriptures as well. And that word is depravity. That's a heavy word and a full word, a big theological word. In our tradition, it's a very important word. We have a way of saying that as total depravity, that all people are totally depraved. That's what Genesis chapter 6, verse 5 is getting at. And what that means is not that like human beings are as bad as they could possibly be, that we're just all bad and there's nothing good. But what it does mean is that all of us, because of sin originally and sin now, every single thing we do is tainted by sin. It's colored by sin. There's nothing in us that is innocent. There's nothing that is totally pure. There's nothing that is holy in and of itself because we are depraved. You might think, good night, that's really hard. I don't think I can believe that. Are you serious? Well, yes, and it's not that hard to see. I mean, think about even children. Children, we love you, I love you. I was a child one day, at one time, and I remember my own depravity as a child. I remember a friend of mine, we were talking not too long ago, and we were talking about stories of our own children, and he shared this story, which I think a lot of us will be able to sympathize with. One time, his family was out to eat, and as they were out to eat in this restaurant, one of their children, who I think was about two or under, was having a hard day, which some of our children can do. And as they were at the table, one of the children decided it was fun to throw food on the floor. And dad said, we're not going to do that. Don't do that anymore. If you do, we're going to go out to the car and we're not going to be able to enjoy dinner together. And the child was old enough to understand that. And the way he tells the story is the child went like this, picked up the food, looked at dad, and dropped it right down. Like, what are you going to do about it? Where does that come from? That comes from depravity, right? That comes from depravity. I mean, more seriously, how could a nation murder 6 million Jewish people trying to exterminate the entire Jewish race? It's depravity. How could human beings, for thousands of years this has been true, for thousands of years have sold and trafficked other human beings as property? How can that happen? Because of depravity. Well, how can you and I, all those things that we regret so much, those things we've done that we wish we could take back, where does that come from in us? It comes from this reality of depravity. The world is a fallen place, and we are fallen people. We have all fallen from God's original intention for us in his good creation. This is a reality that the scripture is making very clear as the story of Genesis continues. And what we're going to see is God, the reason why God sent the flood. In Genesis chapter 6 and 7, God sends this flood that we talked about, remember kids? And he wiped off, he says, even more difficult before that, he says, I'm gonna wipe the face of the earth clean of these image bearers that have fallen because it's gotten so bad. And he found this guy, Noah, who was righteous in his sight. He said, okay, Noah's okay. I'm going to work with Noah. But even after the flood, Noah sinned and his sons sinned. And we see that right away. Sin continues because we live in a fallen world. It is fallen, and it's a problem that we can't undo. So that's so important. We got to understand that because of what God says after the flood. And it's the passage that Owen read for us that we're focusing on this morning. And that's going to bring us to point two in just a second. What God said after the flood is the foundation, the origin that we need to give us some sense of understanding for today. It'll give us vision and it'll lead us into the good news. So that gets us into point two. What did God say after the flood? I'm going to summarize it this way. God says life still has purpose. God still wants life. God still wants life. And I'm going to unpack just that idea. We see this so clearly in Genesis chapter 9, verses 1 through 11. So I'm going to focus on that, and then we're going to move to a big why and kind of answer the why question at the end. But let's just see how God shows us so clearly that even with the fallen world, God says life still has purpose, and he wants life. There's three ways we see that. First, God promotes life. After the flood, God promotes life. Look again at verse 1 in chapter 9, and we're going to look at verse 7 too. It says, so after Noah and his sons and all the animals have been off the ark, they're on the land again now, God blessed Noah, verse 1, God blessed Noah and his sons, saying to them, be fruitful and increase in number and fill the earth. And then in verse 7, as for you, again, be fruitful and increase in number. Multiply on the earth and increase upon it. Now, if that sounds familiar to anybody, it should, because it's just restating what we heard God say in Genesis chapter 1. Remember that? After God had created everything, he gave this blessing to the first human beings and said, I want you to be fruitful and increase on the earth. Fill it, multiply, and rule and subdue it. This was the first thing that God said. And now God is saying the same thing, be fruitful and increase, fill the earth. And he's saying it into a fallen world. Don't miss that. He's saying this into a fallen world. And he even acknowledges with this encouragement and this command that it is fallen. Because in verse 2, he goes in to say something that we did not see in the original creation story, where he says, the fear and dread of you, human beings, the fear and dread of you is going to fall on all the beasts of the earth, on all the birds of the sky, on every living creature that moves on the ground and in the sea. Something's changed. Whereas before, we as God's image bearers in the original creation had this harmonious relationship with all of God's creation, including the animals. Now that's different. Now there's fear. Now there's killing. And there's going to be eating of the animals as well. This is a change. This is part of the fallenness of the creation that God made. And yet, this is the key, God promotes life. Be fruitful and increase. Second, we see God protects life. Protects life. Verses 5 and 6. Speaking again to Noah and his sons, he says, and for your lifeblood, in the Hebrew mind, blood is what carried the life of the entity, the person. So the lifeblood is where the life resides in the person, okay? And for your lifeblood, I will surely demand an accounting. I will demand an accounting from every animal and from each human being too. I will demand an accounting for the life of another human being. Whoever sheds human blood, by humans shall their blood be shed. For in the image of God has God made mankind. What I want you to see here is that even though human beings are fallen, even though human beings are depraved, every inclination of their heart is evil all the time, that hasn't changed, we're going to come back to that, God still protects life, human life. He puts a value on it. So the value is, it's good and it's right and no one should take it because it's still holy, it's still sacred, it's still made in the image of God. We still bear God's image, though not perfectly, it's still there. And you see, he protects it because he gives this threat, this judgment. If anyone takes human life, their life is going to be demanded of them. This is what he's saying here. He's protecting life. And the reason is because human life is still made in God's image. Remember that? I gave this metaphor in 2 weeks ago. I believe it came from John Calvin, but I could be mistaken as I thought about it last week. But I think it is. There's this image of a mirror, right? And to be made in God's image is to reflect God. On one hand, it's also to be representatives of God in his creation. But like a mirror reflects God, so we as humans, I'm sorry, like a mirror reflects, we in, what am I saying? The image of God in us is like a mirror. We reflect God into the world. And sin, if you could picture a mirror being hit or just shattered, that image is now, you know, distorted, it's corrupted. Some of the pieces of the glass have fallen out of the mirror. So you can still see pieces of a reflection in it, but it's not right, it's not perfect. But it's still there. Similarly, the image of God is still at work, is still there in us. We still reflect him into this world. And God says, no one can take your life. Your life is, no, human life is sacred. And if anyone takes that, there is a consequence of death. So God is protecting life. Third, God preserves life. So God is promoting life, God is protecting life, and God is preserving life. Look at verse 8. It says, then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, I now establish my covenant with you and with your descendants after you and with every living creature that was with you, the birds, the livestock, and all the wild animals and all those that came out of the ark with you, every living creature on earth. I establish my covenant with you. Never again will all life be destroyed by the waters of a flood. Never again will there be a flood to destroy the earth. There's a really important word in those verses that is mentioned twice, and that word is covenant. See that twice. God is making a covenant with Noah and all the living creatures, Genesis tells us. When you see covenant in the scripture, we're going to be looking at a number of covenants as we go in this series. This covenant is unique because God is just making a unilateral covenant with no stipulations on it. But a covenant, usually in scriptures, is God, here's a simple way to think about it, it's God making a promise and a pledge that is relationally structured and has mutual expectations. So God is usually says, I'm going to do this, and I want this from you, and this will be what will happen because I'm making this promise. Here God is just making this promise to all living things. He says, I will never destroy the earth with a flood again. And that little qualifier can be confusing because you think, well, then is God going to maybe destroy the earth with something else, like some, it's like an asteroid's going to fall from the sky or, you know, fire or something. It's like, no, I think God is saying with this, I will never destroy the earth again the way that it just happened. And I think we can say that because in verse 8, God makes this promise at the end of it. He says, as long as the earth endures, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night will never cease. I think he's making a promise that never again will life be wiped out from the earth the way that it just was. God is going to preserve the world. He's going to preserve life on the earth till the end of time when he finishes his purposes. I was talking with a couple of guys a few weeks ago when it was like 100 degrees in late September, and we were sitting around at a flag football practice, and we were just talking about how hot it was, and we got talking about climate change. We started talking about, man, can you believe this? This is crazy. We started talking about all the stories that were going on in other parts of the country. And as we were talking, the conversation took kind of this sad turn, and one of the guys is like, I don't know how human beings are going to make it. How will we ever find our way through this? I mean, if this earth just keeps going this way, we're going to be wiped out. And I had this thought as we were talking. I was like, hey, let me kind of like just play with this thread for a minute. I shared this with them, and it was this. I said, what if if we could go back to like 1915 in the USA, 1915, and if we could tell someone in 1915, hey, in just the next 65 years, so up to 1980, in just the next 65 years, you're going to have World War I, one of the bloodiest, most gruesome wars in history. You're going to see the Great Depression in America, and it happened to other countries as well. You have the Bolshevik Revolution in Russia, which brought about one of the most horrific communist regimes ever. You're going to have World War II. You're going to have the Korean conflict. You're going to have the Vietnam War. You can even throw in the assassination of one of the U.S. presidents, John F. Kennedy. If you went back to 1915 and told someone all that's going to happen, under the Cold War, don't forget the Cold War with the USSR, all that's going to happen in just 65 years, but don't worry, because at the end of that, life on the whole face of the earth will actually probably be in a better shape. People will have a better quality of life, and there'll be more people than there are now. They probably would look at you and say, you're crazy, right? How could you think that? If you knew all of that was going to happen, you'd think, no, that's the end of all things. The reality is, no. Bad things, hard things, horrible things have been happening for hundreds and thousands of years, and yet the world is still here. Life is still flourishing. Why? Because God is preserving it. God has promised that He will. He is going to promote life. He does promote life. He's protecting life, and He's preserving life on this earth. God is the sovereign creator and ruler of all things, and as long as He is, and we are safe under His care, everything is in His hands. Now, what I want to finish this morning is to get into this one big question. As we're seeing God make these promises, we're seeing that God is promoting life, protecting life, preserving life. I want to ask, why? Why is He doing that? Especially in a fallen world, in a world full of image bearers who are in rebellion against God, who are not trusting Him and not obeying Him, many of whom, most of whom, don't know Him. Why is God still doing this? Why does He still want life? Promoting it, protecting it, preserving it. Well, that brings us to our third point. Third and final point, because of this. Life is still good, but more importantly, God is our Redeemer. God will redeem it. Even though this world has fallen, life is still good because we have a Redeemer. So, life is still good, even in a fallen world. Just as the image of God that I mentioned still remains in us, even though we as human beings have sinned and are fallen, so the goodness that God pronounced over His creation. At the end of the creation story, remember, God looked at all things and He said, "This is very good." That goodness still remains, and you and I know that. There's two things that my mind continually goes back to in life over and over again. And I don't know why. It's memories that are burned into my mind. One is probably 15 to 20 years ago. I was in northeast New Mexico. I was standing in the middle of the San Juan River, which if you've never been there, it's amazing. I believe the reservoir is, I forget the name, doesn't matter. So I was standing in this trout swarming river at dusk in August, and the bugs, if you know about, you know, streams, there's bugs just flitting all over. The water was kind of spraying up in the air. The sunset was just behind me, and the water's making that amazing rippling sound that it does when you're in a stream. And on the end of, I was fly fishing, and on the end of my line, I had the biggest rainbow trout I've ever caught in my life, and it jumped about 5 feet out of the water and then plopped right back down. That image, the smell, the sound, the view is just burned into my brain. I love it. Another moment is, and I've shared this before too, another moment that my mind goes back to is when our first daughter, Libby, was born, and Lindsay and I heard her cry, her first cry. That moment is one of the best moments of my life, and my mind can go back to that moment and see it, see the doctor, see the nurses, see Lindsay, see everything. Why my mind tends to go back to those memories and others like them is because they are reminders of the goodness of life. Even though life is hard and there is pain and there is sadness and there's trouble in our world, there's so many moments of good. We have been blessed with a good world and a good life. And all of us, if you think about those places where your mind goes back to, you know that. We all know that. Life is still good. But what's most important for us is not just that life is good, but that life is redeemable. Life is redeemable. So just before our passage, there is a verse in chapter 8 that can, when you first read it, can just seem like it's a mistake. You're like, wait, I think the translators messed up or the printers messed up. This shouldn't be here. And it's verse 8:21, the second half of the verse. And it says this. So Noah has just made a sacrifice to God, and God is responding to Noah. And he says, never again will I curse the ground because of humans. The NIV, I don't think, translates it the best way. The ESV would translate it better, I think. Never again will I curse the ground because of humans, because every inclination of the human heart is evil from childhood. So we say that again. Never again am I going to curse the ground because of humans, because every inclination of the human heart is evil from childhood. Now, the reason why you would think that's a mistake if you're reading through again is because the reason God sent the flood earlier in Genesis is because of the same thing. It was because every inclination of the human heart was evil all the time that God sent the flood. He sent this cleansing, this like wiping of the problem from the face of the earth. But now he's saying, I'll never do that again because of the same thing. You go, what's the change here? Why is God changing that here? As Bible scholars and theologians talk about that, here's a short answer. And I'm framing it kind of rhymy so it's easier to remember, okay? But here's the point. Humanity doesn't need a fresh start. Humanity needs a new heart. That's what we're seeing here. And God is saying, humanity doesn't need a fresh start. What humans need is a new heart. We have a heart problem. We need a heart that is freed from sin. We need a heart that is no longer inclined to evil all the time, a heart that is free from that, a heart that is able to respond to God with love and faith and obedience. So God says, I'm never going to wipe the earth clean again. God, in his love, instead, he says, I'm going to promote life, I'm going to protect life, I'm going to preserve life, because I have promised to send a Savior who will redeem life. Jesus Christ, we know the end of the story. We saw, Doug preached this last week, as soon as sin entered the world, God made a promise that we can see it in Genesis chapter 3, that even though the one who tricked the woman and the man to eating the fruit and bring sin into the world, the serpent, Satan, even though he's going to continue to attack us, and God has promised he's going to stamp out Satan's power and crush his head. That was, Doug, remember he mentioned that, was a kind of this foreshadowing of the gospel in some sense. And we're going to see that promise is continuing to play out here. God says, people don't need a new start, they need a new heart. And so even in a fallen world, life is redeemable. And God is going to work to redeem what has gone wrong. He's going to work to fix it, not just wipe it out or start over, like I mentioned with the kids. And I love how in verse 6, you can kind of see this foreshadowing take place again. Because in verse 6, think about this. It's those who have taken life that must have their blood shed. It's like this consequence for the wrong they've done. But through the gospel, we're going to see that it's through that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, he sheds his blood willingly so that we can have our lives. That we can have our lives eternally and abundantly with him in a renewed and perfect world. Life is redeemable. God's going to change us. He's going to wipe us clean, cleanse us, forgive us, and give us a new life in and through Jesus Christ. So, what do we do with a story like this? As people in 2022, how do we apply this going forward this week? How do we think about this practically? I'm going to give us two thoughts. First, and very, very clearly from the passage, life is good. Life is good. Life is sacred. And as those who are made in God's image, those who are made to value and believe and act similarly to God, we also, as his people, should be about promoting life, protecting life, and preserving life. Life is good. So to circle back where I started with this couple, and this is what I did share with them when we were talking, that couple who said, I don't know if I could ever bring a child in the world, and so on and so forth, said, no, life is good. This world is good because God has this world in his hands, and he's working to redeem all the problems in this world. He knows you. He sees you. He loves you. If God gave you children, have them. Celebrate that. For all of us, if God gives us children, praise God. And let's have those children, right? Life is good. Trust that God is preserving the earth. Another thing, we could never, ever overpopulate this earth. God would never have that happen. He knows what he's doing. Life is good. He wants the earth filled with his image bearers. Let's trust him in that. We would never overpopulate the earth. So for all of us, God wants us to be about life, to be for life in every way. You can think about with the environment. God made this promise to all living things. You remember that? God cares about all living things. We should too. As his image bearers, God gave us the stewardship responsibility of caring for his creation. So we should be about the environment in some ways. That's part of being for life in the ways that God is for life. We should be about the life of those who are in need of most help, the poor and the destitute around this world. There are many who are dying from things they don't need to die from, whether it's illnesses that we have cures for or food and water we could help provide them or whatever it might be. We should be for them. We should be for the unborn human lives. Human life begins at conception. We should be for human life, promoting it, protecting it, preserving it. All of human life, from the embryonic stage to the hospice care stage, we are for all of it as God's people because God is for it. So that's one way that I think we very practically hear God speaking to us through this passage. In every way you and I have the means to be about promoting life and protecting life and preserving life, God's encouraging us and commanding us, do that, be like that, be for it. Two, remember God's grace. Remember God's grace. Even though the story of Noah can be a bit difficult at times, it is a story of grace, of God's mercy, how he's fulfilling his promise to bring about ultimate redemption. God, for you and me, God doesn't want to just, to get back to this language, give us just a fresh start. He doesn't want you just to have a fresh start. Now do better this time, kind of thing. He wants to create a whole new heart in you, a whole new way in you. He knows the depths of your and my sin. He knows our failures. He knows our mistakes, every single one. He knows them better than we do. And he knows that we have no way to fix all of that or overcome all of that on our own. He knows that. But Jesus can. Jesus can overcome all of that. He has overcome all of that, and he's done it for us. Not because of the good things we've done, not because we've merited it or earned it or worked hard enough, but in spite of all those things. Jesus gives us salvation simply by grace, in spite of all the ways that we fail, in spite of all the foolish things we do, in spite of all the ways we turn from God. He comes to us and provides for us redemption, freedom from our sin, its power and its consequences. This is the good news of the gospel. Through his blood, Jesus has cleansed our hearts. He has washed us now and made us pure in God's sight. And by his Holy Spirit filling and empowering us, we can walk in this newness of life. He's taken our heart of stone and given us a heart of flesh, the scripture says, where we respond now with gratitude and faith and love to God. So this week, remember, even in the midst of the fallenness that you see, you read about, you yourself are part of, remember that God is for us. God is for you. He loves you. Trust in his care, rest in his power, and look forward to the fullness of the redemption he will bring about at the end of all things. Let me pray. Father, we do thank you for your kindness, your grace, your mercy. We thank you that you, as our creator, are for us. You have good intentions for us. You are patient with us. We thank you that even though we all have turned from you so far, even though we all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, and even though the wages of sin is death, by your grace, you have come to us and provided us redemption. You have freed us from sin. You have saved us. Thank you, Jesus, for what you've done on the cross, that through your death and your resurrection, we have forgiveness and hope of eternal life, even now. We ask that you would help us to take to heart what you have showed us this morning. Show us your goodness all around us. Open our eyes to see the goodness of this world. Open our eyes to see your work, your hand at work, redeeming and fixing all things, even now through Christ. Help us to follow your lead in being people who promote life and protect life and seek to preserve life as we can. Lord, we love you. We thank you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we turn now to our time of communion as we do every week. And this morning, what I want to point out to us is that as we receive communion this morning, the hope that we're talking about this morning, our hope in Jesus, is made visible to us through the bread and the juice and the wine. Another of God's promises, another of his covenants is here for us to receive this morning and actually hold and taste and ingest into our person that Jesus Christ, God's Son, has accomplished fully and finally our redemption. He has accomplished it all, our salvation from sin. That through his death and resurrection, Jesus has overcome our fallenness, he's overcome our depravity, he's overcome our guilt, he's overcome our death. Because through his death, his blood shed has washed us clean so that by faith in him, all of us who put our faith on Jesus as the Son of God who died and rose and is coming again, all of us may be and are forgiven. And we again have fellowship with God forever in his eternal kingdom. This is the good news this morning. So this morning I invite you to come forward and receive the bread and the juice. Receive it with joy and thanksgiving if you are in Christ by faith. And as you reflect on the depths of God's love for you, his love that propelled him to send his Son as a sacrifice for you and me, come forward with a sense of security and thanksgiving and celebration. Because God is for us, and he will finish what he has started. So for this meal, as we say every week, this meal of communion is for those who have put their faith in Jesus. For everyone who's trusting on Jesus Christ, as the gospel presents him to us, that he is your Savior and your Lord, knowing that he died and rose again, I invite you to come forward this morning and receive communion with us. And so with that said, I'm going to invite everyone to stand. Please stand as we prepare to hear the words of institution. So in a moment, I'll read and we'll recite from the screen. And all who are coming forward, please just come forward through the down the center. You're going to be given bread. You can dip it in the cup and receive that way. And then just go back to your chair, whichever way makes the most sense for you. Well, let's hear what Paul said to the church in Corinth about this meal. He said, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you, that the night the Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" And so with one voice, let us as one church declare the mystery of our faith, that Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Hallelujah. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving, the body and blood of Christ broken and shed for you.
Would you stand as we close our service in song?
Who, oh Lord, could save themselves, their own soul could eat? Our shame was deeper than the sea, your grace is deeper still. You alone can rescue, you alone can save. You alone can lift us from the grave. You came down to find us, let us out of death. To you alone belongs the highest praise. You, oh Lord, have made a way, the great divide you is. For when our hearts were far away, your love went further still. Yes, your love goes further still. You alone can rescue, you alone can save. You alone can lift us from the grave. You came down to find us, let us out of death. To you alone belongs the highest praise. We lift up our eyes, we lift up our eyes. You're the giver of life. We lift up our eyes, lift up our eyes. You're the giver of life. We lift up our eyes, we lift up our eyes. You're the giver of life. We lift up our eyes, lift up our eyes. You're the giver of life. You alone can rescue, you alone can save. You alone can lift us from the grave. You came down to find us, let us out of death. To you alone belongs the highest praise. You alone can rescue, you alone can save. You alone can lift us from the grave. You came down to find us, let us out of death. To you alone belongs the highest praise. To you alone belongs the highest praise. To you alone belongs the highest praise.
Amen. And now, church, as you go from here, may God assure you that the earth is His and everything in it. May He give you hope, knowing that He who knows the end from the beginning is working for good in all things for you who love Him. And may He grant you strength to persevere in faith as you believe that He has redeemed and claimed you in Christ, and that He who began a good work in you will finish it to the glory of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.